Hello and welcome to Science Solutions. I'm Leonard Zane and I am joined here via remote communications with Dr. Paul Gardner-Stephen. Now, Dr. Gardner-Stephen is a scientist and researcher and lecturer at Flinders University in South Australia. Luckily, he's a bit closer to us right now. We're talking to him in Washington, D.C., and I will introduce Dr. Gardner-Stephen at the moment so people can see who he is. Welcome to the show, Paul.
Thank you very much.
And I'll give a little background on Paul Gardner-Stephen. He is a research fellow with Rural, Remote, and Humanitarian Telecommunications at Flinders University. Today, our program is called Communicate Anywhere, because Dr. Gardner-Stephen has developed and is in the process right now of inventing and developing a new way to network cell phones. And this, we think, is a very exciting technology that is now on the horizon. And Dr. Gardner-Stephen describes himself as, quote, the digital version of a blacksmith, crafting creative and skilled solutions to a wide range of problems. His research interests include networking, scalable computing, mobile devices, mobile communication infrastructures, disaster and attack resilient technology, spam countermeasures, and the application of these to make the world a better place. And so today we're actually talking about Dr. Gardner-Stephen's humanitarian efforts here with this exciting new technology, and which you call Serval, right? S-E-R-V-A-L?
That's right.
And what is Serval, and what are your goals here? What are you trying to accomplish with this cell phone networking?
So fundamentally, the Serval project is about getting mobile phones to still be able to communicate when the telecommunications infrastructure, like phone towers and the links between phone towers, go down, for example, during a disaster, or just in areas where it's never existed. So many places in the developing world, or in both the United States and Australia, we have a number of smaller communities in more isolated rural areas that don't really get the full benefit of mobile communications that we enjoy today.
So if I happen to be out on a camping trip in the wilderness here in the USA, and an emergency comes up, and I want to reach somebody, but there are no cell phone towers or relay stations around to where I can actually be able to contact anybody, this is where your emergency or contingency technology enters in, right?
Yeah, so for example, if the local ranger station, or maybe on some of the hilltops, they had small little repeater units that your phone could connect through one of those and find its way back to the ranger station, for example, or to the local county sheriff's station, or just, you know, connect out to the mobile communications network itself. And the only thing that you might need to carry in addition to your phone is a little unit like this. This is a prototype of one of our mesh extenders that helps the mobile phones go a useful distance without needing to rely on the mobile phone towers.
All right, so a mesh extender, as I understand it then, is a type of miniaturized radio repeater, and a radio repeater is a relaying type radio that then takes the signal from the cell phone and manages to transmit that over a longer distance than a cell phone could with just, say, Wi-Fi.
That's right, and perhaps what might be helpful for viewers, we have a video that we've produced talking about what we're planning to do for the mesh extenders and why we think that they're an important new development.
Well, very good. Then let's pause and look at this video that Dr. Gardner-Stephen has prepared, which is about 3 minutes long and explains a lot of things about what the goals are of the Serval project and what activities Dr. Gardner-Stephen has done so far. So here we go with the video.
Mobile phones are a vital part of modern life. Most of the world's population now has one. That's almost 7 billion mobile phones around the world. But there's one big problem. These devices are totally dependent on mobile phone networks to function. Earthquakes, wildfire, floods, war, and other disasters can destroy these networks, leaving thousands, if not millions, without any way of reaching help when they need it most. Another weakness is that mobile network coverage is limited in remote areas like here in the Australian outback. This makes life difficult for people who live, work, or travel in remote areas but still need access to mobile telecommunications. And for other people, particularly those in developing countries, mobile telecommunications can be simply unaffordable. Even a short call can cost hours of wages. That's why we've spent the last 3 years working with the New Zealand Red Cross to develop a solution. We've created software that enables mobile phones to communicate directly and privately using their built-in Wi-Fi and without depending on a mobile phone network. Let me show you how it works.
Our free and open source software has been tested in Nigeria, New Zealand, South Africa, United States and Australia. We're able to make phone calls, send text messages, share photos, gather news, and even environmental monitoring. Across rivers, via balloons, in seas, deserts, subway trains, caves, and underground power stations.
Due to the limitations of Wi-Fi, we have also created the mesh extender, a set-and-forget, pocket-sized device that provides 10 to 100 times the range of Wi-Fi. Linking multiple mesh extenders creates a mesh network that enables communication over even greater distances. The result can be described as two-way radio for the 21st century, combining the reliability and accessibility of old-fashioned two-way radio with the rich digital multimedia experience of modern smartphones. Even if only one phone has our software installed on it, other phones nearby can download the software from that phone, they can keep their existing phone number, and get reconnected to the people they care about, even in the middle of a disaster. We now want to take our existing mesh extender prototypes and turn them into a consumer-ready product. And this is where we need your help. If just 2% of Australian mobile phone owners made a one-time contribution equivalent to their monthly mobile phone bill, we would have the funds that we need to give to the world a powerful backup mobile telecommunications system that uses the smartphones they already own. If you want to partner with us, visit our Indiegogo campaign page and help us to bring this technology to the world as soon as possible.
Very good, Paul. So now we have seen the video presentation. And can you now tell us some more about Serval in your own words as to what your progress is so far, what you're trying to do right now, what you see in the future, and the various steps you're taking?
Sure. So I'd say where we're at now is we've been able to demonstrate, the possibility and the feasibility of what it is that we're trying to do. So we have software now that can be downloaded onto an Android phone that can talk to a mesh extender or to some extent can talk to other phones directly so that people can make private phone calls, they can send text messages to one another, with that encrypted so that you still have privacy in these situations, which we think is tremendously important. And of course, privacy laws don't stop during a disaster. So if you need to talk with a doctor about your medical situation during an emergency, that really is private information that should be remain private in that kind of situation. And we also have the ability to share files. So one of the things that's actually quite interesting with that, we think, is that you can have a map for an area that when other phones come into the area, they'll actually get a copy of the map from other phones that already have it. So anyone who's traveled any great distance and then had to try and download a massive map update for the GPS app on their phone can certainly appreciate that being able to get that kind of information quickly and easily from other phones in the area that already have it. That would be quite helpful as well.
So, What you do then is you install software in the cell phone, let's say wherever you are, wherever the emergency might be, and then the other cell phone coming into the area would need to have that software as well. Is that right?
That's right, but in fact, one of the ways that that other phone can get the software is, you know, for example, if we were in an emergency situation together and I had the software on my phone and maybe, you know, you're looking at your phone and you have no signal and you see, hang on a minute, who's this guy over here talking on his phone? I'll go and see if I can borrow his phone. And then I might say to you, hey, like, I can do better than lend you my phone. You know, and so I'll tell the software on my phone to offer itself to your phone, and then we'll kind of, you know, go through a procedure of transferring it onto your phone out in the field without any internet connection, without any supporting infrastructure. It's just purely a transaction between the two phones. And then a couple of minutes later, you've got the software on your phone, and you can now start participating in this contingency emergency network as well.
All right. So if I have a mesh extender, which is another way of saying this is a miniaturized radio relaying device, the range on this right now, of my understanding anyway, of the range of what your device currently can extend, that with the mesh extender repeater relay radio, you can add maybe a couple miles to the range of a cell phone, something like that?
Yeah, so it would depend on where you are. So where I am here in downtown DC, you know, in amongst the big buildings, it might get, you know, 200 or 300 meters, perhaps a quarter mile. In more open terrain, so a few months back we were here on the National Mall, and we could go from the, let me see if I can remember the names here correctly, the is it the George Washington, is it the monument or the memorial?
The Washington Monument, that's the obelisk,
yes, sir, from,
that's the Washington Monument,
That's right, and then, and which is the memorial, the columned building at the other end of the reflection pool?
Oh, well, that's the Capitol building.
No, sorry, the other end of the mall.
Oh, the other side. Well, there's a Jefferson Memorial near there, Thomas Jefferson Memorial, right.
My apologies for my poor memory of this. But so in, you know, there out in the mall, we were able to get about 3/4 of a mile with the unit simply in our backpacks. So we didn't have them mounted in any special kind of way. They were just being carried about. And it's one of the things that we see as being really important with this kind of technology is, you know, it's great if you can mount antennas up in a high location and, you know, sort of taking into account all of the best practice for this sort of thing. But we actually want it to work and get useful ranges, even if you just put it on your kitchen table or you have it in your backpack or in a pocket. And, you know, so these ranges that we're quoting are in that kind of environment. And we know that people with model aircraft that use the same radio that we're using in these units are able to get, in very ideal conditions, around 60 to 80 kilometers. And while that's not feasible on the ground, certainly, you know, a couple of miles or even, you know, several times that in good conditions, with a little bit of sensible antenna placement is quite feasible. But beyond that, the idea of the mesh extenders is that they actually talk to each other as well. So if there are 3 or 4 mesh extenders between you and somewhere else, in principle, they can actually carry your communication a little bit like a dot-to-dot, hopping from each mesh extender to the next.
And perhaps you may be able to develop mesh extenders with further miniaturization and even more range.
Yeah, that's right. So we're just using a radio on one particular frequency that's available to us. But there are certainly other frequencies that have even better propagation characteristics that we can look at as we go along. And this is, you know, as you will have seen in the video, you know, we're looking at, you know, really developing improved prototypes and you know, seeking the resourcing to enable us to do this so we can explore some of these things and make something that will be as effective as it can be for the people who need it most.
So what kind of range would you like to have? I mean, of course, not intercontinental here, but what do you think might be feasible given technology and resources?
So I think it's to come at the question from a different direction. Apparently around 80% of people's phone calls are less than 4 kilometres in distance. So, you know, around 2.5 miles, you know, is sufficient to get a large majority of people's communications. And so I think if we can come up with a solution that, you know, in an urban area can get, you know, 2 or 3 miles of range, I think that would be tremendously enabling and give people a, you know, a really good contingency communication system. And one actually that they would probably use even when times are good. It's not going to replace cellular carriers by any stretch. For, you know, if nothing else, the other 20% of calls are over much greater distance. And in many ways, that's where the revenue for carriers often comes in from, and the other services that they provide. And of course, they can provide a much more reliable service than we can. But, you know, the prospect of being able to call, you know, your local friends and people in the neighbourhood without charge will mean that people will hopefully use this technology regularly, so that when an emergency does happen, they already have it installed and they're already familiar with it, which is really important in an emergency or disaster, because it's, you know, it's the things that you already know how to do that you will use in those situations.
All right, now we're going to display your website anyway for people who might be interested in this technology. I understand we can't support any kind of commercial ventures in any of our programming, but I understand that you are crowdfunding the development of this project. And for people who don't know what crowdfunding is, why don't you explain that?
Sure. So I guess crowdfunding is a way, particularly for things where, you know, the value is for you know, society in general out there, and the cumulative value to society is you know, is obvious, but it's maybe, you know, sometimes it is for a commercial product, but other times it's for something that you know, traditional funding modes aren't really suited to. So maybe it's a documentary about you know, a marginalized people group, or maybe it's an independent band wanting to record an album. And so for a variety of these things, crowdfunding has become quite popular, because you know, for many of these things, people will say, well, you know, like, to me that has a value of a few dollars. And, you know, in, for example, recording an album, you know, maybe they only need $10,000 or $20,000 to do that. And so, you know, you get a thousand people pitching in, and suddenly, you know, they actually all end up with this new album, and it's at a much lower cost to them than it traditionally would have been, and the recording artist actually ends up in a much better position as well, because, you know, they've recorded the album without incurring you know, the big overhead costs of a recording label. And so I guess sorry, go on.
Well, there are various sources on the internet then that actually set up voluntary funding by the general public of various types of ventures. And you might name what some of these are and then name the one that you're using.
Sure. So the one that people most likely will have heard of is Kickstarter as a mechanism for doing this crowdfunding. The one that we're using is called Indiegogo. And as the name kind of suggests, that there's a quite large number of independent artists and the like who, you know, seek to crowdfund and you know, their artistic endeavors. And so it's we find actually that it's a really nice platform that fits in with our social and humanitarian perspective of wanting to make the world a nicer and fairer and more interesting place.
Right. So we're going to display the link for crowdfunding of your Indiegogo site, where you're raising funds to do that, for anybody who might be interested in just looking at these things. Again, we're not promoting what you have. We're just informing people this is what you're doing. You're not actually using venture capitalists, and you're not going to governments for this. You're looking for popular support. And just coincidentally, yesterday, I was at a little shop in Pasadena, California, near a hobby shop, where they're doing 3D printing. And 3D printing is development of, they actually, computer feed in information to a device that actually lays on layer upon layer in certain configurations of plastic, in this case, to build objects, and that's called 3D printing. Well, anyway, this particular little firm has been there for about 8 months, and I had walked in for the first time, just asked them who they were, and they had wanted to get something like $54,000, and I think they went to Kickstarter or something. Well, they've raised over $200,000 already in you know, very short time, which amazes me, because I also have an economics show. Besides the Science Solutions program, we have an economics solutions program. And here we're talking about a major source of capital for people from just general interested public. And so crowdfunding is a brand new concept here. I don't think it's been around all that long, at least not in the way we know it, using the internet.
And it is, it's really interesting, as you say, the rapid turnaround and the you know, for the people seeking the funds, and also for the people putting it in, that, you know, it's really a very economically efficient kind of solutions. I mean, one of the, you know, obviously I'm running a crowdfunding campaign myself, but I've also contributed to some as well. And so one of them, it's for a vacuum food storage system. And by signing up to the crowdfunding campaign, I think for something like $125, I'm getting something that, when it's retail, will probably be twice that price. And like you're saying with this this hobby store, I think they were hoping to raise $75,000, and I think they've raised nearer $400,000. And so it's a tremendously effective tool, and you know, for them as a business now, they can go forward without having large debt, and that enables them to, you know, to grow their business more rapidly. And so, you know, these benefits really flow into society in a whole pile of really nice ways.
And you even have a fellowship through Flinders University, which has provided significant funding. I won't get into the amount, but I would say that in looking at the documents here, it looks substantial. And yes. So, Paul, what are your dreams here and your goals for this? This is obviously your invention. It wouldn't look to me very practicable to attempt to patent something like this in various countries. The cost would be very high, and it would take a long time. And it seems to me, from the way you describe this, that you have broader, more humanitarian interests in mind.
Yeah, so really we want it so that everyone that has need of it can have it and have it for free. And so perhaps a good way for me to answer the question is actually to start at the beginning of where the Serval project began, which was when I first heard about the Haiti earthquake. I still really distinctly remember the moment of driving along in the car to work and hearing about what had happened there in Haiti. And in, you know, my background in communications, I knew that if that society that was already very strained lost the ability for communications, you know, amongst government agencies and the police and the local population, that would really have profound negative impacts on that area. And as I heard from people who were working there following the disaster, unfortunately that's what happened. But I remember in the car, you know, as a human being, we have our coping mechanisms when we hear about bad things. We try to think about the ways that that they'll be solved. And so I remember thinking, oh, look, you know, that they'll be able to fly in new mobile communications towers and deploy them, and, you know, it won't degenerate into you know, sort of this unfortunate lawless kind of situation. I'm thinking that happily to myself when the person on the radio says, and the airport in Haiti has been severely damaged. They have only one runway that they've managed to clear some space on, and it's one plane in or out every half an hour with air traffic control out of Florida. I'm resourceful. I'm thinking to myself, okay, so they can't do it by air, but Haiti is connected to the Dominican Republic by highway. They'll be able to truck gear in. It will take a little bit longer than flying it, but, you know, it could still be an effective solution. So I'm thinking this happily to myself when the person on the radio then said, and practically every road in Haiti has been turned into rubble by the earthquake. And it was amazing to see some pictures and see just how true that statement was, actually. So I'm still a resourceful person. I'm thinking to myself, okay, so those two are out. There's a harbour. They can load up a container ship. It will take a little bit longer. And they can sail around into Port-au-Prince Harbour and start rebuilding. I'm thinking that to myself when the person on the radio said, and the harbour in Port-au-Prince has collapsed. And I still really remember the rawness of that moment, that all of my wealthy Western kind of coping mechanisms, I realized that the people in Haiti were really going to suffer in a way that we'd hope that no one ever need to suffer. And that really set me thinking about what could be done. And after a few weeks, I really realized that the mobile phones could communicate directly with one another, and that the only reason that they aren't able to until now is that it's an accident of history, if you like, that the mobile phone networks were really based around centralized infrastructure rather than this independent mode of CB radios. And so as a result, we set about making, if you like, the software to let a mobile phone behave like a 21st century CB radio with all the nice features that we're accustomed to, but with this ability to operate independently, and the very strong view that this needed to be available to anyone who needed it free of charge. It needed to be free to redistribute, so that if only one person gets it into an area, they can share it with everyone else there, and that community can get connected, defend itself, and really progress economically, socially, and in quality of life in a variety of ways.
So you are beginning a decentralization approach to this type of communication, where it is currently centralized, and your range is very limited, is what you're talking, but you're talking about people who are out in the wilderness or in the middle of a disaster situation where normal communication is down, and here's a way to get around this. And so I see you, Paul Gardner-Stephen, as quite a pioneer, and here you are talking about this gratis for everybody, everywhere, to help people. You sound a little bit like Nikola Tesla.
Well, hopefully I'm not going to erect large towers trying to beam power everywhere. But in many ways, communication is power. And it's interesting, actually, that the recent reports by the United Nations highlight not merely the economic value and social value of communications, but make clear that their understanding of the Declaration of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights actually means that the ability to communicate is actually an intrinsic human right. And so we see ourselves as really helping to see that right facilitated for as many people around the world as we can, and particularly the vulnerable, who for a variety of reasons are not easily served by the conventional cellular infrastructure.
Well, that's a very interesting parallel. You know, Professor Michio Kaku of the City College of New York, a theoretical physicist, has described the internet as a global telephone system, in effect. Now, yours isn't global, yours is decentralized, and yours is limited range, but what a great idea, I think, for helping people who might be in trouble or isolated, and here's a way to do this decentralized. And I see this as a great stride for human freedom and for rights, as you say, the right to communicate. Wow, freedom of speech, the ability to speak, and the ability to get in touch with others. What an exciting technical stride this is, appears to be for me. Now, you mentioned privacy. How safe is your system and your software from people eavesdropping?
It depends on how you want to look at security. In terms of eavesdropping and being able to hear or read your communications, it's actually very good. So the cryptography that we're using to encrypt the phone calls and the text messages that people send to each other with our system is, I believe, at least as strong as what exists in modern cellular networks. In fact, in many cases, it's probably substantially stronger. Our view is, if you're going to build something, you build it well. And of course, because we're building it today and not 15 years ago, or when the cellular network protocols that we're using today were designed, we can use some of the modern innovations and the increased capability, actually, of the modern devices that carriers and the the cellular equipment hasn't really been able to work on as an assumption.
Okay. So anyway, Paul, I think we're coming to the end of our program today. Is there anything that we left out, that I left out, that you left out, that you would like to cover?
I think we've covered the bulk of it. Thinking back to the statement about decentralization, I think an interesting point actually is that I think history will show that the 20th century was exceptionally unusual in the way that we centralized a great many systems, and indeed technology enabled and made them much more efficient. I mean, you've talked about 3D printing as well. You know, sort of before the Industrial Revolution, it was, you know, cottage manufacturing really was the backbone. Then the Industrial Revolution meant that centralizing that was much, much more efficient, and we reap the benefits of that every day. But as 3D printing matures and you start being able to print, you know, spare parts for your car, or actually your whole car to begin with, or, you know, pieces for your house, suddenly actually, you know, decentralization or re-decentralization actually will occur, I think, in a variety of sectors. And so we see what we're doing with telecommunications in that as being, you know, a natural and perhaps one of the, along with 3D printing, one of the leading edge of you know, the return to localized capacity and capability being, you know, equitable with the large centralized approaches. And hopefully that will help foster, you know, really vital and prosperous regions and, you know, the smaller states and cities and things that struggle to compete with a centralized approach.
Well, this is really fascinating, Dr. Paul Gardner-Stephen. You are a research fellow at Flinders University in South Australia, about 9 miles, I understand, outside the city of Adelaide. And you are a pioneer. You are spearheading something that looks very exciting. And again, filling a gap, helping with something that we don't have, especially for emergencies. And I think you're doing wonderful work. I'm certainly going to look into what you're doing more myself. And I wish you all the best. I think you're doing just fabulous work for civilization, really. And you're right at the cutting edge. And I see a wonderful perspective for you. So I wish you all the luck.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And thank you, folks, for tuning in to this program. We hope you've enjoyed Science Solutions on this Communicate Anywhere. And we look forward to inviting you to see our next program. Thanks a lot. I'm Leonard Zane.